moving forward, teams have to have, you know, you have to be a vital piece in order to be a part of the organization. I'm just like, you know, I think I might have worn my welcome out here.
Today on the show, I have retired NBA champion and graduate of the University of Memphis. Earl Barron is up next. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Fifth Quarter Podcast. I'm your host, Sandy Adams, and this is where we dive into the stories of retired athletes, their perseverance, their resilience, their career pivots, and finding the passion they crave. Get ready to dive into the true stories from the athletes themselves, talking frankly about finding their true calling after their competitive careers end. So grab your iced tea, because I'm from the South. Get ready to be motivated and inspired, because this is where the real stories are told. Today's guest is a retired professional basketball player hailing from Clarksdale, Mississippi. A graduate of the University of Memphis, where he played all 4 years, won an NIT championship, and made it to March Madness. But his biggest accomplishment on the court is playing with the Miami Heat from 2005 to 2008, during which the Heat won the 2006 NBA championship. He had a career spanning 14 years, playing both in the U.S. and across the globe. Welcome to the show, Earl Barron.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you for having me. Go Tigers.
Exactly. I had to wear the shirt today. I try to wear, when there's Memphis players on, I try to do that.
I should have coordinated with you. I should have known better.
You would be surprised. Like 2 years ago, I was doing, because I'm vice president of the rebounder, so I was doing little videos, and I have to call out Will Coleman. I got him to do a video for, we could post on social media, and he wore a red shirt. I was like, dude, why didn't you wear blue? He's like, I didn't think about it.
Yeah. At least it wasn't orange. At least it wasn't orange.
That is exactly right. That is so true. So just a little thing. We ran into each other a few weeks ago. Bluff City Collective had an NIL event at the Rendezvous here in Memphis after one of our games. And you were there and I got to meet you in person. And of course, that's kind of my stick now. If I meet an athlete, a retired athlete, I'm like, hey, you want to be on my podcast? So you were gracious enough to say. So let's start off with, what are you doing now and where do you live?
I live in Wentzville, Missouri. It's kind of similar to what Collierville is to Memphis. You know, right. It's just the outskirts, a little suburb, but been here probably 2 years. And I just recently started working with Northwestern Mutual as a financial representative. So went to school as an engineer, but that quickly changed once I got to Memphis. So I changed my major to business, but finance, money, and is something that I've always wanted to, you know, dive into, and trying to find something flexible, you know, raising two boys in a new area, having the flexibility to work from home and in the office, something that, you know, piqued my interest. And after a couple of interviews, you know, they said that I would be a great person to come in. And so it's, you know, it's a work in progress, but I know that through my connections and, you know, me being a people person and, you know, just from passionate about something and love something and I want to do it, I'm going to get it done. So that's where I'm at.
You mentioned your two little boys. I've seen pictures of them. They are adorable. They're like little yous.
Yeah, that's what everybody says. They say, I can't deny them. So it's like, hey, they're my little twins. I love them.
Exactly. And how old are they?
They are 16 months and 7 years old.
Wow. That's crazy. Especially the 16 month old. So let's talk about, let's dive into, when did your fifth quarter actually start? Like, when did you decide that basketball was over as a player?
So, guess I can say I was, when I got married, right when my son was born. Mm-hmm. And I think I was in the process of doing a lot of overseas stuff. So my wife being the type of person that she wanted to be overseas, and I'm like, hey, somebody has to stay and, you know, man the house. you know, we lived in Arizona at the time. And then, you know, throughout my career, I heard a lot of people talk about missing out on their kids. Yeah. You know, first steps, going to school, changing diapers, just through their career, because a lot of guys have children, but, you know, playing in the NBA, it's basically a full-time job, similar to college. You know, people don't realize how tough, if you're, you know, you stick to the schedule. College is basically not a 9 to 5. It's like a 6 to 10.
Right.
So, exactly. You know, the NBA, you know, a lot of film, a lot of travel. You do have downtime, but you're on the move all the time. So especially when you're overseas, you know, being halfway across the world, sure, it's something that, I just kind of said, hey, I, at that point, I think I had a couple injuries and I was like, you know what? If something else comes up, I will accept it and take it. If something good opportunity came up, and then I started to lean over towards the coaching thing in the States. Right. Got a job at the Suns G League team. So I went to volunteer and it went so well. They said, hey, we're just going to bring you on as one of the assistant coaches in player development. So that was my first, you know, steps of kind of leaning towards it. And at the time, I still could play. So I would play with the guys. I would work them out. I would play one-on-one with them. And, you know, people was like, you still can play. And I was just like, you know, I can't, I won't change, you know, being around my son at the time. I only had one at the time. So it was tough, but, you know, I'm here now. You know, I can't change it. Could say I probably could have played, you know, 3-4 more years, but at the end of the day, I would have missed out on a lot of things, you know, in my son's life.
You know, I've talked to several guys who talk about how, you know, they struggle with wanting the love of wanting to play, but then the love of wanting to watch their kids grow up. And, yes, you know, especially when they're young, they miss a lot out of their lives, because they change so quickly as youngsters. When did, you know, I mentioned you grew up in Clarksdale, Mississippi. Mm-hmm. When did you start playing sports, and was basketball like your first sport?
Basketball was my first sport. My dad was a coach. He was the athletic director at the junior college where I live. He was pretty good friends with Nolan Richardson over at Arkansas.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, he would make trips over there. And I can vaguely remember traveling here and there with the team, but just being in the gym all the time. My mom taught ninth grade English at one of the junior highs, Higgins Junior High, and which is 3 or 4 blocks from our home. You know, Clarksdale is really small. So
sure it is.
A lot of times when I would get out of elementary school, their school would still be going on. So I would end up going into the 7th period PE class and finding the basket. You know, when I was fourth, fifth grade, finding the basket where all the bums were, all the people that really couldn't play.
Right.
And I would get in there and just shoot and mess around. And then eventually by the time I was 6th grade, you know, I found myself going in and they were like looking forward to me coming in just to fill a spot. And then when school would end, I would just hang around and shoot. Me and a couple other teachers, kids, you know, would shoot and do stuff in the gym. So my mom had to finish her lesson plan. So I found myself in the gym pretty much every single day, you know, and but basketball.
That was a great way though for her, because you were doing something that was proactive and it was keeping you busy and teaching you life skills and things like that. When did your height, because you were 7 feet, correct?
Yes. 6'12".
I tell
people 6'12". Yes.
When did your height start becoming taller than everybody else in your class?
So it's funny, there was a girl when I was 5th grade, we were about the same height, and it's probably 3 of us when I went to elementary school. And 6th grade, I think I probably was a couple inches taller than her, really didn't think anything of it. So 7th grade, I think I was probably 6 feet. And then I think my big growth spurt hit when I was like 6'4", ninth grade. 6'3" and a half, 6'4", ninth grade. And that summer, I tell people this story. That summer was my first time getting on a plane, traveling. I went to visit some cousins in D.C., Silver Springs, Maryland, right outside of D.C. for the summer. I was supposed to be gone 1 month. And my aunt, well, she's kind of my cousin, but she had 3 boys. And my other cousin lived in the same neighborhood. He had 2 kids and we were all the same age. So they lived in a little neighborhood and they had their own little city in their little complex.
Right.
So, you know, we did everything. Fish, play games, hide and seek, football, basketball, walked up and down the street, did exercises, dance. We did it all. So after a month, I told my mom I wanted to stay. And she was just like, well, I don't see nothing wrong with it if they're okay with you staying. So I ended up staying 3 months. Wow. And I didn't get back to Clarksdale until maybe a week, 2 weeks before school started. So I didn't really see anybody the entire summer.
Right.
So I'll never forget walking into school and all I got was oohs and ahs. And I was just like, why is everybody looking at me so funny? And then it was like, man, you grew. And I was like, yeah, I probably grew a little bit, but I didn't realize it. So come to find out, we did our physicals. They measured me at, I think I was like 6'7". So I had grown 3 inches.
Oh,
I grew
my
three
God.
Inches in 3 months. So that's kind of when my growth spurt started to take off. Did not play much ninth grade. Ninth grade, I was okay, but we had a lot of talent in my city. So at 6'4", we had a lot of guys, 6'1", 6'2", that could do a little bit of everything. They were dunking. You know, I couldn't even dunk at 6'4". So when I went on my growth spurt, the coach was like, hey, things have changed now. And I played every single minute from there on out.
So was it hard to pick up the game? Was it something you fell in love with?
I fell in love with it, but not to the degree of some people that watch, like,
obsessed
with Kobe's move, Garnett's moves, and Jordan's crossover, and we rewind tape. I just loved watching the Bulls. Love watching, you know, I just like good basketball. So we had WGN, of course, and so I watched a lot. I watched a lot of Bulls basketball. So I grew up a Jordan fan. Watched all their championships, and you know, as I got older, I just started to pick the game up from older players, college players, guys who had played professionally for a little bit here and there in my hometown, which weren't many, but the ones that I did kind of attach to, we would get up and go to the track in the morning. My mom was like, hey, take them. So they would come pick me up and I would go, you know, we would do sprints and stuff and we'd play pickup. And that's kind of where how it took off. And guys used to dominate me in the gym and I would be the last one to get picked. And then I just remember as I got better and taller, I was, you know, started being the third guy to get picked,
right.
The second guy to get picked. The next thing you know, I was always, you know, the first guy to get picked. So where I went, it was crazy.
When did the colleges start recruiting you?
I guess I started getting some letters maybe the end of my 10th grade year, around 11th grade, because I was 6'9" in 11th grade. So my mindset was totally off scholarships and signing and things like that. My mindset was, I was like, hey, I'm going to Mississippi State. My whole graduating class, we're going to be engineers. I'm going to enter in an engineering program. If I can get a scholarship, I'll do that as well. So knew Rick Stansberry, got to bump into him, have a good conversation. Haven't seen him since, you know, basically I was in high school, but you know, he was recruiting me. And
what college was he at?
He was at Mississippi State at the time.
Okay.
So, you know, he was recruiting me, but I started getting letters in the mail. My coach started saying, hey, and it was from Coastal Carolina, Georgia, Ole Miss, you know, Southern Miss, you know, letters start piling in. And I didn't get overwhelmed by it. I just was just going to school, having fun, playing basketball, you know, thinking about graduating. And when that time comes, then I decide, you know, where I was going to go to school. So I didn't really make any commitments or anything like that.
What interested you about engineering?
Yes, I love math. I love computers. So I just knew that, you know, computers would be something that everybody would use, and the way technology was going at the time, a lot of money, a lot of new jobs. And most of the people that I surrounded myself and competed with in school, that's what they were going to do. So I kind of told myself, if they can do it, I can do it too. And I just pushed myself in every class. So if Sandy made a 97 on the first test, I was like, got to make sure I get a 98 on the second test because I don't want to be outdone. And that's kind of a bunch of my peers in high school pushed me to, you know, be a scholar athlete and take on top of my mom. But, you know, having that competitive mindset, I use that not only on the court, but off the court as well.
You know, it's really interesting. You know, you surrounded yourself by people that you wanted to do better. Like all of you wanted to be better. You wanted to do better. And I see, you know, a lot of kids these days that are in groups of that are not about pushing themselves to be better. And it's all about, you know, what clothes they're wearing and what shoes they're wearing and, you know, who has the latest whatever. And I love that fact that, you know, you, all of you as a group are wanting to be better than what you had been. You know, one thing that's interesting is that your mindset as a high school student was about your degree and about what you were going to do with it. Did you have any aspirations about going to the NBA or playing after college, or was it a means to an end?
I mean, it was a dream. I have little things, little documents, little papers. I can't think of what you call the little things that you write your dreams of where you're going to be in 15 years.
A diary, a journal.
Bury it, whatever they call
it. Oh, I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
We did that for and it's probably still buried to this day. we did that for our honor society that we had when I was in high school. And one of them was, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I think when I was around 11th or 12th grade, I said, you know, I want to play in the NBA. So knowing it was a reach, but at the same time, it was just something that, you know, you're going to dream. You know, if I make it, I make it. I don't. And like everything started happening so fast post-college to where you go from it not being a reality to it's once I got in the D-League, I was like, okay, it's in reach now. Like I'm competing with guys who've had contracts, who've been on teams. And once I start competing and seeing where I kind of stood, like I would have some good games against former first round picks. And I was just like, if I can do this on a regular basis, there's a good chance that somebody might look at me. And as long as I'm ready, I can go in there and give it my all. And if I don't make it, you know, I was prepared. I was ready. Right. So that's the mindset I took, you know, going forward the rest of my career.
What was it like going? So you did end up choosing Memphis. What was the reason you chose Memphis over Mississippi State?
I would boil it down to some procrastination. they have an early signing period and a late signing period. I think the early signing period, I basically had my mind made up. I was going to Ole Miss or Mississippi State. So at the time, I knew all the coaches. I knew all the players. Mm-hmm. Ole Miss. So I was kind of closer, leaning to Ole Miss. Plus, it's a little bit closer than Starksville. Sure. But all of my friends most of my friends from Clarksdale were all going to Mississippi State for the engineering program. So I was just like, you know, why not? You know, we can all stick together and it'd be cool for them to watch me play. And so I waited till the late signing period and Mississippi State signed like two of the top centers in Mississippi. I was honorable mention when I graduated and they were both Danny Dozen, we call it the Danny Dozen. It's the top 12 players in the state. So one was the number one player in the country named Jonathan Bender. He signed with Mississippi State, later ended up going to the draft. So that's something I look back and say, hey, had I signed with Mississippi State, that scholarship would have opened up and I would have had more playing time. But another guy, he was 6'10", I think 260, coming out of high school. He was the number one or two linebacker in the state. And he also played basketball, but he was huge. At the time, I was 175, 180.
Oh my God.
Super, 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 super skinny. So, and so Memphis, how I don't know if a lot of people know this story, but Memphis was looking for some big men, and one of the coaches for Mississippi State, after they, you know, they basically were like, hey, you can go to prep school. I think Ole Miss said the same thing. And it's like, you can go to prep school. My mom was like, no, you're on track. You're doing things you're supposed to do. There's no need for you to go and just, you know, basically spend another year in high school playing basketball and take a step back school-wise. And I was, you know, it's different now. I probably would have probably done it now that I look back at how, you know, the prep school and the basketball things work. But ended up, Memphis contacted them and they said, hey, there's a big man down in Clarksdale. But the thing was, there was a guy who played two or three years before me who was 6'11". His name was Carlos Boozer. I mean, Carlos Booker. I'm sorry.
Okay.
And he was 6'11". So really good player. He ended up going to Southern Miss, but I guess they didn't realize that he had left and went on. So they came down to check me out. And at the time I was playing tennis. So I talked to Coach Jones a few weeks ago and he was just telling me, he was like, man, what are we doing down here? He's like, this kid's out here. And it's like, what kind of basketball player is this? And so when they came and watched me play, they sat in the stands and they watched me practice. And they were just like, you know, at the time I went from going out for fun to 11th grade. I went out for fun 11th grade. And the lady said, hey, if you can beat all the boys, you can play boys singles.
So I was like, for tennis.
For tennis. So okay. Ended up playing singles matches, beating all the eighth graders, beating all the ninth graders, started competing with a couple of the seniors. And she was just like, and the two seniors were twins and they played boys singles. I mean, boys
right.
double.
Right.
So she was like, you know, if you beat a couple more people, you know, the singles job is yours. And so I ended up doing that. So my senior year, I was playing mixed doubles.
Okay,
so
you left that off the form. Oh my God.
I'm
you
left sorry. The, I'm sorry.
You left the so tennis off. Okay.
I played tennis for 2 years, made it to state both years. First round boys singles, I ended up playing the number one boy in the state. That didn't go very well. I think I scored maybe 1 point. So it was like a 6-1, 6-0, but his serve was pretty nasty. So he was deserving of that number one ranking. But my senior year, I played mixed doubles and basically just came up with the strategy that once I hit the ball and they lost control of where I was at, I would just charge the net. And my coach said she'd never seen anything like, you know, someone my size going to the net. And I would literally go to the net. And if I had it in this hand and the ball would go here, I would switch hands. And a lot of times I would just spike it towards whoever the girl was standing, because a lot of times she would just duck, because it was the guys would do it too. But it's just hard for when you think you're going to lob it over someone and basically it's going to go out. If it goes over my head, it's a good chance it's going out. So long story short, they came and watched me play. Then we went to go play pickup at the junior college. Me and a couple high school guys, we played pickup with some of the college guys and made some shots, was handling the ball, threw a couple lobs to some people, had a couple dunks. And they were just like, you know, they found out I had passed my ACT. That I was a good student. You know, they talked to my mom. It's like, we want him to come to Memphis. So I looked into it. We took an unofficial visit. Me and my mom drove down, and I was
who was the coach at the time?
The coach at the time was Tick Price.
Okay.
Tick Price was the coach, and Johnny Jones was the assistant coach. So, you know, as you know, Tick Price ended up stepping down prior to the season starting. Before we went to Maui, Johnny Jones was the head coach. And, you know, one of the players was suspended, and I ended up moving into the starting lineup going into Maui. So I think I was like 195, you know, playing against these seniors who were 250, 260. So I was just like, I got to put on weight quick. But, you know, I ended up in Memphis. It's literally closer than Ole Miss and Mississippi State. I think there was one other person in my hometown that went there. So he would drive and commute every weekend. And so we would link up on Fridays, and if schedules permitted, he would pick me up and we would drive down and spend time in Clarksdale. And Sunday afternoon, we'd get back on the road and drive back up. So it was, you know, everything happened for a reason. I wouldn't change anything for where I love the fact that I'm a tiger and not
a
bulldog or a rebel.
That's right. That is absolutely right. So what was the difference? You get to Memphis and, you know, people, you know, there's all this big thing about NIL and that kind of stuff these days and the transfer portal. And you stayed 4 years at Memphis. And I think that was back in the days when players committed to, and they wanted to stay 4 years and they wanted to, you know, be a part of a team for the long run. But what was the difference between playing high school ball and playing college ball and being a student athlete at the college level? I think people miss out, you know, you referred to it as it is a full-time job. So for you, what was that transition like and what were the hardships about that?
I mean, I think the fact that my mom being a teacher, she kind of instilled a lot of discipline when it came to, you know, studying and just being on top of my books. I was a AB student. So anytime I got a C or a D, I was like, this is not, you know, this is unacceptable. Like, it's not cool. I didn't like B's, didn't like C's, you know.
Right.
Most of my elementary school career, I was straight A's, you know, some B's. And then high school, when you start taking, you know, advanced classes, a couple C's start popping up. And I was just right. Like, man, like, so I just always challenged myself, you know, on the academic side. So once I got to college, you know, the structure of, you know, getting up, going to the track, going to get breakfast, making sure you're on class on time. So it's, you start making schedules for yourself. You start to do a lot of planning. You start to make sure that, okay, if I'm here by this time, I can eat. I can, if I have to rush, I can rush, but I have to be across those tracks by this time. I have to beat the train. You know, my class.
Beat that train.
My class, you know, my first class might be on the other side of campus. So it's just like, I have to leave myself time. I don't want to be, you know.
Right.
Don't want to be late. Don't want the teacher looking at me thinking that, you know, I'm procrastinating or I'm not taking her class serious. So, you know, I made sure it was important that I got there, got me a good seat, you know, ask questions, be attentive. Perfect attendance was another thing that I did in throughout high school and elementary that once I got to college, rarely did I miss it. It had to be a really long night or something crazy happened,
right,
or I overslept in order for me to miss class. So, you know, that was another thing that I made sure that was important. But like I said, going back to being a full-time job, you know, getting up in the morning, making sure you're eating breakfast, going to class, going to study hall, between classes, you might have a workout, you might have to go do cardio, you have to do sprints, you might have to go do individual workouts, then going to study hall, and then going to practice. So, you know, there were times when you get back at 9:30 and it's just like, I just want to go to sleep. I just want to shower, write my paper, do whatever I have to do, go to the computer labs. And, you know, it was a grind, but you know, once I found my little niche and found out what I could do and what I couldn't do and when to push the limits, you know, times when guys were like, hey, let's go to a party. You know, I'd be like, okay, doing the math in my head. let's go do it. So it was fun.
You know, I listened to you talk about that and the structure that you had growing up and the competitiveness. And it almost, from a person looking on the outside looking in, it also makes me see that you were already building that resilience because you, I think you said you transferred during your competitive career in the pros to 20 teams. I think that's what you said.
Give or take, yeah.
So that, you know, that resilience that you've built early on, I would think would help during all those years where your career was just up and down because you didn't know exactly what was going to happen next.
Yeah. So I kind of took the approach that, I don't know where I heard it, but if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. So
sure,
I always made sure that, and the only time that I would say it did happen was I had an injury. And then another time I just had so much fun in the summer that I came into training camp and I was a little bit, I wasn't out of shape, but
right.
I wasn't at my peak. So once you train for a summer and you show up to training camp or you show up to a tryout and you feel a certain kind of way, you know how much you weigh, you know how your body feels on the defensive end, you know how you feel when you're jumping, like you know what it takes to show up somewhere and be 100% prepared. And then you also know when you show up and you're like, man, I'm kind of tired. I only did four sprints or, you know, not being able to jump and move and as agile as you want to be. And then you look and see, it's like, oh man, I'm 257. Like I was 245 last year and you know.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it's to the point where you understand, like at my peak, I knew where I weighed. So once I started getting on the high end of, you know, working out, trying to eat right. And, you know, of course you're going to drink. So, you know, I would try to make sure I monitored how much I drank or how much I ate and when I ate good, when I ate bad, and just trying to balance in that. And I knew exactly where my numbers were. And that all kind of came from being in Miami. So that taught me a level of professionalism and taking care of your body. And, you know, Pat Riley at the time, still to this day, he's a big believer in body fat. Right. And I tell people, I said, you'll never see a pudgy Heat player. You know, nothing against pudgy players, but
that's right.
If you're going to play in Miami, they have a high standard of body fat. And I think the guards is 7% or under. At the big man, I think it's now it's 9% or under. So it used to be 10. So if you weren't 10%, you really couldn't practice until you got your body fat down. Some guys like Shaq, they let him get away with it because it's pretty harsh at his size to get down. But he was probably in the best shape outside of the Orlando side when he was in Miami just because of that standard. So
let's talk about, you switched your major in college, or did you start Memphis with a business degree?
I started Memphis with engineering. Like I was taking advanced trig and calculus three, like I was taking as a freshman. And I think I had an 8 o'clock class that the teacher was curving. It was so hard. The teacher was curving. And I think the highest grade was like 50 something, 60 something on a couple of the first tests. And so I'm just like, man, I can't pass. You know, he's curving it and the 60 is an A. And the whole club was just so many people in there. They were getting 20s and 30s. And I'm just like, is this what I'm going to have to, you know? And so I end up meeting with one of the advisors in, you know, study hall. And, you know, we talked about it. And she was like, you know, you can do it. She's like, but it's going to be really hard. And you got to know you're going to have a lot more math coming with this. And she said, with your schedule, it's going to be, you know, really tough. So I went back to the drawing board and didn't want to do education, nothing against my mom, but didn't want to do the education side. I just wanted to do a little something more challenging. So I figured that, you know, one day I maybe could own or start my own business. And I went into business management. And, you know, I fell in love with it. So that's how I kind of ended up there. And now being in the business that I'm in, basically I'm my own business and I have to build my business and, you know, build my brand and, you know, go from there. So it's funny how I ended up in this career, how my degree changed and vice versa, whatever.
So, you know, you're in college and you've changed your major and you've fallen in love with that. And as you get to be a senior, are you thinking about the draft or is that still just kind of, it is if it is and it's not if it's not?
It basically became, I knew I was, I'm a realist. I'm always optimistic, but I try to 100% with myself and, you know, looking across and knowing who was coming out that year. I knew every stat. I knew every accolade, you know, who was good, who I had a chance to beat out. And I didn't do many workouts. I did one workout my senior year with the Knicks.
Right.
And it was me, a guy from Kentucky, who, you know, rest in peace, he passed away with a heart condition. I think his name was Mark Stone. So, you know, that's another thing throughout this career. You cross paths with a lot of guys who, you know, I can't even count on two hands how many have collapsed on the court, who've been in car accidents, who've had cancer, who've been healed. Like, it's just been a lot to where you look around and just like, man, it's a blessing, you know, every day. But just thankful to my path and crossing paths with so many cool guys and all the different places that I played. So,
you know, so you put your name into the draft that night when the draft happened. What was your feeling when your name didn't get called?
I mean, only working out for one team. The Knicks had two picks. I can't remember who they picked the first round, but the second round pick, I knew they needed a big. And the one workout I did work out was Marvin Stone and a guy who was 7'4", 7'5", named Slavko Varnes. He might have been from like Slovenia. I'm not 100% sure, but he was like a question mark in the NBA draft. But because of his height, you know, he was just high up on a lot of people's lists. But when we did the workout, I had a really good workout. So I was just like, you know, there's a slim chance that they could pick me. But Marvin Stone was kind of, you know, he's a McDonald's All-American. He went to Kentucky. You know, he was projected late first round, early second round. So I was just like, all right, if they don't take Marvin, they're probably going to take the other kid. And, you know, I'll just keep my fingers crossed. And I was just like, they call my name cool. If not, you know, next step, preparing for summertime and workouts and things of that nature. So when they call, they end up drafting Slavko Barnes. So I was like, well, they're not calling my name in any of these other picks because I didn't work out for any other teams. But one of the coaches kind of told me in New York, he was asking me, why didn't I go to Chicago? And Chicago is where they have the you know, the mini camps and the little pre-draft stuff. And he said, you would have been, you know, you would have been really good. It would have been great for you if you had, you know, gone up there. But, you know, I didn't get an invite. I knew what I could do, but my numbers weren't the best coming out of Memphis. You know, being on loaded teams, that's the thing about playing on a really good Division I team is every year there's talent coming in. Every year there are McDonald's All-Americans coming in. There are Mr. Basketballs coming in. So you have to, you're never secure. You're never safe. You always have to be ready, be prepared, your A game, show up every day to practice, show up every day in preseason. Because if not, you know, you can be someone that's there 2-3 years and a freshman come in and just dominate you every day. And you find yourself, you know, cheering on the sideline, which is nothing wrong with it. But, you know, I love to play. I just love being on the court. And yeah.
So you know, I love the fact that you always had, from what you've told, you've always had that plan B or C. Like, you've always been like, okay, if this isn't going to work out, I'm still going to give it my all. But then I know that this is there as well. And not everybody has that. You know, you go into the summer and I look at your career and then I look at other people who have gone like in the draft or higher in the draft and their career just fizzled or they just, you know, lasted a couple of years or something like that. And, you know, as much as people want to put so much emphasis on getting that high pick soon, you know, you look at Tom Brady, I think he was, what, 199 in his draft? Like six other quarterbacks, I believe, were picked before him. I think it's more about
Nikola Jokic was a second round pick who everybody, when they called his name, they were like, who? And now he's a few years later, fast forward, he's a, you know, two-time MVP. So
exactly.
I never really got caught up in it because I, from watching the game and knowing players and seeing them and seeing their productivity, is like, you know, you don't have to be, especially the guys that weren't drafted, you know, guys like Udonis Haslem, like, you know, those guys can make it. And those guys kind of paved the way for a guy like me. Like, you know, if I work hard, I can, you know, give it my all, and the right opportunity comes, I can find myself, you know, on someone's team or starting or, you know, have a nice contract. So that's the kind of approach that I had when it came to, once I didn't have my name called, I was just like, well, I still love it. I'm still going to play somewhere. So just make the best of it. And that's what I did.
So you went overseas. What was the first country you went to overseas?
I went to Izmir, Turkey. So I left at, I think I went to, did I go to training camp before that? I want to say I went to Izmir, Turkey, and I was there 8 months. I had a stress. What did I have? Something in my back. My back started bothering me. Never had any injuries in college besides sprained ankles. So overseas, they have their beliefs in ice therapy, weights. So a lot of the stuff we were doing, I would try to do basically what I had done my whole college career. And the strength coach was like, no, that's not right. This is how you, you know, you, this is how you do it. You do it this day, you do it fast, you sweat. And I'm just like, no, that's not how I was taught to, you know, my stance, my form, the way you, you know, the way your reps are going, and everything was just totally different. And, you know, it was cool to have a strength coach and have a weight room to, you know, stay strong, keep your body in to be able to go out there and compete on a nightly, daily basis. But stretching and doing other things that I wasn't doing kind of got to me, and had an injury, tried to treat it, take care of it. And I ended up getting cut from Izmir, but it was cool. I think I remember leaving Memphis, the airport. My mom was there. My godparents were there. My girlfriend at the time, my sister, and everybody was crying. And my mom was like, ah, and I was just like being tough. And as soon as I got on the plane and the plane started going down the runway, leaving the airport in Memphis, sure. I kind of broke down like, man, what am I doing? Like, where am I going? Like, I don't know anybody. Is anybody going to be at the airport? What if they're not there? Like, I started thinking out there. So what should I just stayed and gotten a job and got in the air and then had some, you know, when you fly overseas, they give you, I don't know, whatever, is either first class or whatever the next thing right. is the first class. So you get plenty of food. They bring right. by, you know, good drinks, you know, and at
especially
the time,
on the overseas flights, like that's, yeah. yeah.
So
yeah.
those long flights, and then I watched me two or three movies, and we had a couple stops. I don't know if we had to stop in Barcelona, but we had a couple stops before I got to Izmir. I had to stop in Istanbul, of course. And, you know, it was a little bit of culture shock, but the good thing about traveling overseas is when you have guys who are veterans, if you could say, who've been there, who've been around all the right. different countries, understanding how making sure you get your money. Sometimes yes. they tell you the shadiness of overseas. They tell you how yes. a coach might run a play that makes no sense, where you just got to be like, okay, don't argue with him. Just sure. run the play, do what he wants you to do. But I had two veterans on my team, Glenn Wisby. He was from Georgia, and Alex Jensen, who he's actually assistant coach with the Jazz now. So they were both vets who kind of, you know, we're very unselfish guys, and me coming in at 21, you know, tallest player on the team, I could do a little bit of everything. And once they saw my work ethic, and they basically was like, hey, man, if you're open, shoot. Like, some games I would play the three. Like, Alex was like, hey, you play the wing today, I'll play the four. And the other guy was, you know, he could jump out the gym, so he was a shot blocker and would finish around the rim. So we all kind of played our roles, right. you know, close with their families. Watched my first series. Alex was telling me about The Sopranos at the time. No, that's
oh, yeah.
a long time ago. But I never watched any kind of TV series. So he was just telling me things that you can do to keep yourself occupied, because there's a lot of downtime between practices. And there's a quick turnaround from the morning. We practice twice a day, pretty much every day. And so adjusting to that, and then finding things to keep myself busy when I wasn't on the court, and try to make my apartment as at home as possible.
Right.
Start going to the grocery store, start cooking, you know, had, you know, my Wi-Fi. I don't think I had a game at the time. So a lot of things was, I think I was online burning music and trying to find different games. You know, anytime we could watch a live game that came on early in the morning because of the time right. difference, I would get up at, you know, 5:30 and watch a, you know, early NBA game. But it was an adjustment. I think we had a couple crazy story. We were playing in Istanbul, and we were playing against, they have FS Pilsen and Uker were the top two teams. And FS Pilsen was a beer company. Uker was like Nabisco. It's like a cookie company in Turkey. Right. But they were pretty big, and they had some well-known players. So we were playing in the preseason. And we were playing Uker. So we were at their facility, and they had this little snack shop. And we were taking a break between practices, and they had a little TV, and the TV showed that there was a suicide bombing in Istanbul. So, you know, when you're in the States, you see it, it doesn't really,
yeah.
you know, you're like, oh man, that's messed up. That's sad. But you're in Istanbul, and I'm just like, okay, where is this at? Can you guys tell me where this is? And they were like, oh, that's not even close to here. You know, it's, you know, don't worry about it. You know, that's sad. Things like that happen, you know. Later on that afternoon, they had another one. So
wow.
this one was close to where one of the other teams, like facility and stuff right. was. So I was just like, all right, this is, you know.
And you're an American.
I'm an American. Mm-hmm. First time in Istanbul. And so one of the guys told me one year, he said, you don't get nervous until they get nervous. So once they start freaking out, you start freaking out. So until then, the first time, nobody was just like, oh, you know, it's no big deal.
They're used to
their coffee and tea. They're used to it. After the second one, I want to say it might have been three. So I would say after the third one, then I start seeing my teammates looking funny. I start seeing the GM looking funny. And I was just like, all right, like, what's going on? And so I was like, I want to go back to, I want to go back home. I just want to go back to America. I want to go back to my passport. And they were like, no, don't be scared, you know. And at the time, I was doing really well. We weren't expected to do as well as we were. We were like top two or three in the country. And there was some good basketball in Turkey at the time. And we ended up beating the number one team at one point. And, you know, so things were going good. So they really didn't want me to leave. They got a diamond in the rough for a cheap price. But I really wasn't looking at it for the money. I was looking at it for the experience and just to go out there and kind of create a new slate for myself. Because, you know, I think I averaged 9-5 coming out of college. And then I go overseas and now I'm averaging like 16-8, you know. So they're like, we didn't know you could shoot. We didn't know you could dribble. We didn't know you could do a lot of things. I say, well, I can. And it's, you know, I just want to win at the end of the day.
So did you start, you know, I've heard some of the guys that have been on the show, they've talked about how, you know, they really learned early on about starting to save their money, and they'd see their teammates going out every night, like blowing money like crazy. And with your business background already, was that something that you started early on about preparing yourself?
I would say I saved. People still call me cheap. But I do spend money. I just try to spend it the best way possible. I like to get sales. I like to get deals. I like to, you know, negotiate. You know, I'm not just going to go somewhere and, you know, we go out and spend, you know, a couple of dollars. Like, man, I'd rather spend less than 100 and get it all in one shebang. But I saved a bunch of my money. And then at some point, my mom was like, I think once I finally made it to the NBA, she was like, you need to invest. You need to put your money somewhere besides letting it sit. You know, I didn't know anything about inflation or anything of that nature. So I was just like, hey, I can see my money. It's not going anywhere.
That's right.
Continue to add to it. I don't have any bills. I'm in a good space right now. And, you know, I invested, you know, I learned about the matching that the NBA did. So they match, I think, 140% to whatever you contribute to. So it's a good, you know, one of the best out there. And so at first I was like, I'm not matching. I'm on all my money. And so a couple veterans came to me and it was like, look, man, you want to match. You want to put the max in every time, every year. Like, don't even question it. Don't care how much you're making, you do it. So I would say after my first year, every time I went, even if it was in the D League, I just, when it came to the mark in that box, I would say 100%, just take it out, set it and forget it. So looking back, that was something that's allowed me to be in the situation that I am right now, to be, you know, stable enough to make ends meet even when I might have more going out than coming in on some months. But you know, just thankful for the career that I had, the people that I had around me, you know, my mom kind of instilling me about putting money away, saving, you know, it's okay to splurge and have a fun here and there. But, you know, there were times in my career where I would go, you know, go to Vegas, play poker. I had some good connections out there to where I, you know, had some free comp. So basically I was just paying for my flight and food. So, but in Vegas, that can get very expensive. So
sure it can. Let's fast forward to, you had 14-year career and multiple different countries and different teams. I think you talked about you really liked being in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. I went there. We had relatives. So when I was 5 years old, I went there for 2 weeks, loved it from what I remember. Beautiful country. How did you get to Miami?
Let's
talk about that just for a second and the championship and then we'll go into after.
So quick story. Well, not quick story, just quick rundown. Leaving Turkey, got hurt, came back, I think it was right after Christmas. So it might've been like January, February. So there was only a few more months left in seasons at that time. So I think March rolled around and my agent was like, at the time, he was just like, hey, there's a G League team, Huntsville, Alabama. You know, they're looking for a center. And at the time, they only had 10 players. And the starting center was really good, but he was injured at the time. And I want to say he had to go to Ohio for some kind of court thing. And this is the first week I get there. So I don't know any of the players. We had a pretty good team. And then there are two centers, two power forwards, two small forwards, two shooting guards, two point guards. So the center was gone.
Right.
So I'm just like, okay, maybe they're going to put one of those power forwards at center. The coach ended up putting me at center. So I was a little bit out of shape from my injury. Wasn't in tip-top shape, but I was, you know, working really hard to get back from where I really couldn't do anything because of my back. So
right.
Went to the D-League, finished the season. Summer goes by. Of course, the way the season went, my name wasn't like really knocking down any doors. So I was just like, I'll go back to Huntsville. Like, it's a quick drive. It's close. Right. I knew the coach. I knew some of the players were coming back. I was like, this is could be a good situation. Go back. Had a really good team. Spent the whole year there. And I got a invite to Summer League after that season. But prior to that, I went to the Philippines. And this is probably where what kind of helped boost my career, because in the Philippines, it's very humid, very hot, and all they do is run. Fast break, fast break, fast break, fast break, fast break. So I went to go take a guy's place, and he was averaging probably like 27 and 16 or something crazy. And I was just like, why are they bringing me here to replace you? Like, and he right. was like, man, he was 6'8", 6'9". He was like, they need more size. You know, there are some big guys over here. And, you know, one of the guys was like 7'2", 7'1", 380. Like, he was huge. Went to a small school. So, you know, there was a lot of big guys over there, but I could do a little bit of everything. So, they brought me in, and he was just like, man, you're going to love it. He was really cool. You know, the fact that I was taking his place, I was like, I might be a little salty, but he kind of showed me the ropes, you know, showed me things that I could do. And he's just like, man, if you just go out there and play, and if you can shoot and dribble and do all the things that they say you can do,
right.
you're going to average, if not more, the same what I'm averaging. And, you know, I found myself shooting the ball 20 some times. You know,
I felt like a
real guard out there, but, you know, just posting up, shooting, doing the pick and roll, handling the ball, doing everything, rebounding. So, you know, you have having 35 and 22 was not normal over there. I mean, it was normal. You know what I mean? So ended up getting in tip top shape. So when the season ended, we made it to the semis. We lost. I got back and I had like a week before I had to go to Summer League in Long Beach. At the time, Long Beach was having Summer League, right. and they had about 10 teams there. So I'm probably in the best shape of my life coming from the Philippines. So I go into Summer League, and they have a couple guys who were pretty big name guys. First day of practice, one guy hyperextends his knee. The first center hyperextends his knee swells up. He tries to go out there, couldn't do it. Second practice, and we're doing two-a-days because we got to get it all in and learn the plays before Summer League starts. Second center bumps knees or gets hit in the thigh. He's out. So they have two draft picks at the time, three draft picks, and they had Quintel Woods, who's from Memphis.
Right.
So they had Darrell Wright and Wayne Simeon, who were first and second round picks. One of them was a power forward, one of them was a shooting guard. So they didn't have a center. So they're like, hey, you're going to have to start. And I was like, wow. And hearing stories in the D-League, they talk about Summer League a lot and the opportunity and how that could be a game changer for you. But what they don't tell you is that a lot of times you make these Summer League rosters and you don't touch the floor because they already have certain players that right. are already that drafted. They bring in players from the previous 2 years.
Right.
Now they're on the team, so they have like six or seven of their guys that's already on their team. and it's hard for you to find minutes. So I was in a rare circumstance.
Right.
I'm starting. They didn't draft me. I'm not returning from a previous year. And it was just the first game. This is when Eric Spoelstra was coaching Summer League. So he basically just got his first nod to, you know, coach. And first game, I think I had 12-6. And he was just like, look, you can shoot. You can run a pick and roll. Like, we don't just want you to be a robot. It was like, go out there and play your game. He was like, if you're open, shoot. We're not going to say anything to you about shooting because I'm just trying to play the game the right way.
Right.
And I think the next game I had 26-13. Wow. A huge double-double for Summer League.
Right.
But
right.
For me, I'm just like, hey, I'm playing. I'm in the right spots. The ball's going in.
Opportunity. It was an
I'm
opportunity.
I'm not doing anything special. I'm just the opportunity. So I did that for multiple games. And I think it kind of hit me when a couple of my teammates who were there, you know, this is Summer League. So these are the best of the best across all of Division I. Right. And they were, you know, like, Earl, man, you had 28-15 against the Lakers. And I'm just like, yeah, it was, you know, got the minutes. I just made some shots and the ball bounced my way. I grabbed the ball. And I'm like,
right.
And you were doing this and you're doing that. It's like, man, they should sign you. And I was just like, I'll see if they sign me, they sign me. I was like, you know, I'm still not even, it's not really clicking. And you know, and I think we did play the Lakers when they had Andrew Bynum, they had Ronnie Turioff, they had a, you know, a bunch of picks.
Right.
Sasha, what was it, Busevich, Sasha something, that played with Kobe for some years, but they had a really good squad. And you know, just the Miami's very structured. So they was like, hey, we're gonna run this pick and roll. If you stay here, you duck in, go to your jump hook. And so I was just like, it was just like clockwork. We're gonna do this pick and roll, you're gonna be isolated on that side. If you pop, you're gonna be wide open. And I didn't miss. I probably shot 70% from the field. Wow. And a lot of them were pick and pop jump shots. A lot of them were wide open dunks or duck ins. Basically just listening and learning the game about spacing and being in the right spots, because that makes the game a lot easier when you understand spacing, which a lot of people don't understand to this day. So they invited me to Summer League. I mean, they invited me to training camp. And so ended up, they asked me, and it's like, do you want to come early? Or do you want to come, you know, maybe a month or two before training camp, because we'll put you in a hotel, you can work out at the facility. And I was like, I mean, why would I say no?
Right, you know, exactly.
Not knowing the city of Miami at the time, but, you know, told my mom, I was just like, hey, I'm going to Miami. They're going to put me in a hotel. I'm going to start training immediately, getting ready for training camp. So I was basically there for like almost 3 months, 2.5 months, working out Monday through Thursday, Monday through Friday. They would give us some Friday off. And I basically came into training camp tip-top shape from the time Philippines to Summer League to training camp. Just came in not too fearful of Shaq and Zoe because they came in a couple weeks before training camp started. So we got to scrimmage and I got to see, like, there's a big difference in a big center in college overseas and Shaq and Alonzo Mourning and Michael Doliak and Antoine Walker, you know, Udonis Haslam. Like the size, the strength, the speed, the reaction, everything is different. The guys that can shoot, if you don't close out right, they're probably going to shoot it, make it, you know, 7 out of 10 times. Like, you know, that's what they're paid to do. So making those adjustments and kind of going in, looking around and seeing the guys that I was competing with. And like I said, there was a stretch in before training camp to where we would do pickup and stuff. And a lot of the veterans start coming in and I still was not missing shots. And the guy was like, you keep shooting like this, there's a good chance that you can make the team. And so I was just like, man, I'm just going to make sure I'm hustling, taking charges, if I'm open, take good shots and hope that I make them. And when that time came, you know, you see a couple people not be there then one day. They get called, hey, let me talk to you for a minute.
Right.
After workouts. And he's like looking around like, there's only a few of us still here. And, you know, I ended up just grinding it out. And, you know, next thing you know, they was like, hey, we want to sign you to a contract. When it still really didn't register, I'm just like, man, I'm just playing the game and having fun and enjoying everything out here. And next thing you know, it's opening night. I was just, that was a crazy 2 years, you know, to go from hey, you might not make it to the NBA. You should probably just focus on going overseas, or, you know, going into the real world, and to being on a, you know, NBA, one of the best NBA teams at the time. So,
right. And you got a championship out of it.
Definitely got a championship. And that was a team that had 8 new players, including myself. They made the trade for Jason Williams at the time. Antoine Walker was new. Alonzo Mourning was new. I think he came over from the Nets. James Posey came with Jason Williams. They signed Gary Payton. They signed Shannon Anderson. They signed me. So we had a lot of new pieces. Jason Capono, that, you know, it's tough, kind of like comparing college to having this transfer portal, which I think is really killing the game. And that's another subject. But to bring in 7 or 8 new guys on a team and get everybody on the same page to where we all click and it just starts working. And there was a point to where it's like, man, we got a really good team. Like, it was just like, hey, we go out here and it's like, this is our strategy. This is what we're going to do. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. This is what they're going to do. This is what we're going to do to combat that. And we just went out and we just start just kicking butt night in and night out. And I was just like, we got a really good chance. We ended up going into the playoffs. Playoffs didn't start so well. And I never forget the first, because this was kind of the last chance for a lot of the veterans. So if anyone knows Miami, there's always something going on. I don't care what day of the week it is, what time of day it is. It's always something going on. So we kind of made a pact before the playoffs started. It's like, hey, you know, guys, I know we all go out. Everybody went out. I don't care whether it was golf, going to the club, going to, you know, whatever. Boating, parasailing. Guys just love, you know, being out. And it was like, hey, we're not going to do anything. We're in the playoffs. Let's take this serious. No going out. Let's get our rest. Let's do X, Y, Z. So we were down 0-2, and we had a team meeting. And I think Shaq came in. He was like, listen, guys, this is not working. Whatever y'all were doing in the regular season, whether it's staying up all night, you want to get up and play golf at 5, I don't care. We need to get back to what we were doing. And everybody went back to their regular routine, and we just took off from there, and, you know, we ended up winning the championship. It was an amazing ride. It was a great group of guys, man. You know, I hear podcasts from other guys that say that was probably one of the tightest knit teams that they've probably been a part of, because we would eat lunch together. We would go to birthdays together. We'd be at each other's house. We'd play cards together. We'd go to parties together. We would go to signings. We would do, you know, all kind of things, lunch, pregame lunch, just so much together, to where we had each other's back, you know, on and off the court. And I think that's very important. And that's the disconnect that you have now in college, to where you have guys coming through portals and they've been in other schools. And it's like, okay, I'm not happy here. I want to leave, as opposed to, I want to do whatever it's going to take. And I want to stay here to jail and build that camaraderie to where I know you got my back. I know he has my back, as opposed to he's new. I'm still not sure if they, you know, we're on the same page, or if they got my back like I got theirs. And I think that's the issue right now with you know, the portal and building that camaraderie and that chemistry. Because you think about back when I played.
Are you drowning in work and struggling to stay organized and make progress on your goals? Well, I've got the solution right here. Introducing my success Blueprint Planner. It's not just any planner, it's a planner and a journal, and it's your tool for taking charge of your busy life and achieving your dreams. Ready to make this year your most successful yet? I am. Head to my website and grab your copy of the Success Blueprint Planner today. sandy-adams.com/books.
You think about back when I played, you were there 2, 3, 4 years, unless you're a one and done. And one and done's come every blue moon. Right. Now everybody thinks they're one and done, and that's killing the game.
It is true. And you know, a lot of people around them are telling them they're probably better than they are. And then you have the money issue. You know, the disconnect that I see overall through the league is yes, they're as soon as they are unhappy with something, they're going to go to somebody else. But I also see, you know, if we talk about the internet, you know, COVID made the online classes that much more normal. And I think a lot of colleges are still using that, especially when it comes to their teams, their athletic teams. It's more convenient for their players to be online classes than have to go to in-person classes. And I think that's also a disconnect from not only each other, but from the community and the campus and the students. You know, in Memphis, we've talked about, you know, how do you get the students more involved, because they don't really have a connection with the players at all. And I think there are other schools that are going through the same type of issue. And you're right, you know, the more that a team bonds and has that chemistry, the better they're going to do, because then it's just more natural when it comes to the court. So you stayed there, what, two and a half years in Miami? And what was that feeling when you left, when you were let go from the team?
I mean, they signed, I think my third year, they signed Michael Beasley. They made some trades. And I think my third year, we had a lot of injuries. And basically halfway through the year, guys were just like, I'm going to hang it up. So we signed a bunch of D-League guys. A bunch of guys were on 10 days. So I kind of knew, it was like, okay, moving forward, teams have to have, you know, you have to be a vital piece in order to be a part of an organization. I'm just like, you know, I think I might have worn my welcome out here. And, you know, kind of was like, there are, you know, 28, 29 other teams that I could go to that could use me. So I'll always be hopeful, because I know this is not going to be my forever home. I never had my mind like, oh, I'm going to go to one team and I'm going to stay there duration of my career. I don't know if people remember Tony Massenburg. He played for the Grizzlies and he bounced around a lot, and they called him a journeyman. And I was just like, you know what? I wouldn't mind being a journeyman as long as I'm on a team. You know, if I'm in a rotation, cool. But as long as I'm on a team, being a part of a team, helping them in some shape, form, or fashion, you know, that was all I could ask for. And so I left there and went to Italy, went to Bologna, Italy. And I got hurt the very first practice. I had a bone bruise in my foot.
Oh, wow.
Felt like a sprain, but I knew it was no swelling. And with the bone bruise, it's very, very, very painful. But if you don't do the proper x-rays and CAT scans and all EK, all that stuff, you won't really see it. So they kind of told me it was just a sprain, and I'm still trying to play on it. I'm limping.
Oh,
I'm doing
geez.
One leg jump shots. And they were just like, get out there and play. And I'm just like, I'm in pain. Like, the drugs that y'all are giving me, something's not right. And so I ended up getting a Cleveland Clinic. The agent that I had at the time, they lived in the Cleveland area. So they sent it to Cleveland Clinic, and they, you know, he called and told me, he was like, hey, you shouldn't be walking. You shouldn't be riding a bike. You shouldn't be doing anything. You need, this is going to take 3 to 4 months recovery. So that's when I put on the most weight in my career. So I couldn't ride the bike. I used to run cross country in high school too. So I love running. I love working
that out too.
And so I was just like, man, I can't do anything. So I found myself hanging out with my buddies and, you know, going to parties, drinking, eating junk, you know, staying up late. And I just ballooned. So when I did get clear to get back to, you know, being active, I had put on so much weight, and I'll never forget. I was like, man, I got to figure out how I'm going to lose this weight. And I tell people, that some people don't believe me, I was like, man, I got to do something that cheap. So I really don't want to hire a trainer. And I was just like, what can I do to push myself to lose weight? And this is when P90X first started, you know,
out.
So I ended up doing P90X for 3 months on top of going to campus and working out with some of the guys that were in town and playing pickup and things of that nature. But I ended up losing 30, 35 pounds that summer, lost a bunch of body fat, but you know, just another way of making sure that you come October, August, like I would always cut off, my birthday is August 14th. So I would always say, by the time my birthday comes, I'll go out. I'll still go out, but I'm not going out every weekend. I'm not going out twice. Like, at a certain point, it's just like, all right, you need to be drinking more water. You need to be eating better. You need to be getting up. You need to start doing more yoga. You know, I start doing certain things towards the middle of my career that I knew come August, October, wherever I went, whatever team I went to, it was going to be a matter of, I'm going to be ready. It's just going to be a matter of I did enough or I was good enough or competed enough against the next person next to me to get that spot. Right. And so that's kind of how I did my whole career. I would enjoy a couple months, a couple weeks, and then I would slowly started ramping up. Right. And at a certain date, I was just like, all right, full head of steam now.
Right.
You know,
right.
One more month before you got to be in, you know, Italy, you got to be a summer league, you got to be here, you got to be a training camp. You don't have any, you know, room for error. So,
and it's also being responsible and accountable and understanding that, you know, you're a business, your body, your whole thing is a business and it's got to be ready. Let's fast forward to really quickly, because we are running behind just a little bit and I want to respect your time, but,
fine.
I want to talk about the poker. Like, I want to get into that, and then we'll jump into your how everything went after you left the league. But how did you get into playing poker?
So, in Miami, I think my first year in Miami.
Everything
happens in Miami. So, poker was just starting. So, they had some laws in place to where you have tournaments. Right. And you have what they call cash games, to where you sit down with $500 and everybody else sits down with whatever they want to sit down with. And you sit down and you play against other players. So those are cash games. They had at the time what were called sitting goals. So sitting goals were kind of like tournaments, but it's only 10 players. It's one table and one person wins it all. So I started off playing, I don't know, $50, $100 sitting goals. Right. Just learning the game, and I would just sit there and play super tight. Just wait till I got a good hand, wait till I knew I had a good flop or whatever, and pile all my money in, and I ended up starting to win a lot of sitting goals. So Saturdays when we have days off, I would get up and I would drive to Hard Rock and play poker.
Okay, I want to ask a question. What was the allure of poker? Like, most people, I'm sure, are sitting out there thinking it was the gambling that or the competitiveness of that, but what was the allure of poker as opposed to something else you could have done?
Poker is a, I can't really compare it to basketball, but poker, you're competing. It's every man for himself, but you meet a lot of interesting people. You meet people that, you know, I've met people that have doctorate degrees and master who said, hey, I make money playing poker, and this is something that I love, and this is something that I, you know, divulge into, dive into, read books, right, seminars, and all this different stuff. And I was just like astounding to see how much somebody could win, how fun it was, how relaxing it was. I could sit down at a table and not play any hands, but just like fishing. Like, I can go fishing for hours and not catch anything, but still just enjoy being in an environment. So poker is very similar, to where I can sit down at a table, win or lose, I still have a good time because I decide what decisions I make. Nobody can tell me what cards to play, how to play them, how much to bet. I do it based on experience or the other people at the table. So a lot of people look like, oh, he's a basketball player, he doesn't know what he's doing. I'm just like,
no, because like
you're gonna be walking away with some curse words in a minute when I take all your money,
I think a lot of people out there don't understand that it's not, you know, basketball. I think Josh Minot said it a couple of years ago. He said, everybody thinks we're all great players because we do that highlight dunk. And he's like, basketball is more than a dunk. And it really is. It's if you're playing at an elite level, it's a game of skill in your head. Like, how are you going to put all these plays together? It's not just a dunk. For me, I look at it as, you know, I would think it's interesting that athletes are always, you know, moving around and doing all that, that the off time, you might want to be busy physically as well, but you talk about how you enjoy just being in the moment and being still.
Yeah. So I would, you know, I did a few camps, but it's kind of like you're so busy. And then I look back and, you know, probably could have or should have done more things. But, you know, when you're fully occupied with basketball to the point where, you know, I've had guys who's like, man, I don't even want to watch basketball. I don't want to touch basketball. Like, I've just been around it. And I, my whole life, I'm just like, basketball. I want to watch it. I want to go to the game. I want to go. So I found myself once I got done, I was just like, you know what? It was like, are you going to the Grizzlies game? I was like, no, I'd rather just sit on the couch and watch it on TV or not watch, you know, basketball at all. I still love it, but, you know, I don't want people to ask, why are you not playing? What are you doing? Right. What are you doing? You know what I mean? Especially at, when I was in my prime. So I kind of can understand how, you know, sometimes players can just be like, you know what? I just want a break from the game. And then other people, the season ends, guess what? They're right back in the gym. You know, the Kobe's might take a little time off, but he's that first week after the season ends, he's up at 4 a.m. in the gym. Yeah. You know, that just separates the greats from the mediocres.
That's right. So what was it like? You played in, I think, the 2015 World Thing of Series Poker.
Yeah.
So what was that like?
It was, I guess I couldn't really, I can kind of compare it to basketball to where you grow up watching KG, Tim Duncan, you know, trying to think who else, Ben Wallace, you know, you grow up watching these guys, and then the next thing you know, you're shifted into a position to where now you're on the court with them, you're guarding them, they're guarding you, you know, they're talking trash to you, you're talking trash to them, and it's just like, I can't believe this, like, this is Kevin Garnett, like, I watched you, like, you were, you know, you're my idol, now I'm sitting here banging with you down low, you know, Tim Duncan, you know, Shaq, you know, I'm practicing with him every day. I'm sharing a locker, you know, we're right next to each other in the locker room.
Right.
So poker, you see these guys who make, you know, have done it for so long, and this is their life. Like, this is what they do. Like, this is their end. And you sit at the table and, you know, I find myself Googling them just like, whoa, you know, this guy to my right, he's like the real deal. Whoa, this guy sitting across from me. So, it was fun, but it's kind of like I said, with basketball, you can't really get caught up in it. As long as you're prepared, you just go out there and just like they say in many sports, like they lace up their shoes just like you lace up your shoes. So, you know, if like I like to play tournaments, so every tournament you start up with a certain amount of chips, and I'm just like, hey, I got the same amount of chips as you. Like, you're not that much different than me. You know, my decisions might be a little bit different sometimes, but you know, poker takes a lot of patience. It's a lot of strategy. It's a lot of position. It's a lot of, you know, paying attention. You might miss something. Right. Just the fact, like, you're on your phone or you step away from the table, you might miss something very important that happens at the table that somebody does or says, or the way they bet, to where you're like, oh, next time he does that, he's done that three times and he didn't have anything all three times. So the next time he scratches his head and he throws his chips a certain kind of way, I'm going to call him. Like, I don't care. I'm just going to call him. And sometimes you're right, sometimes you're wrong. But it's just something that it's fun. I used to tell my ex-wife that she was like, how can you sit at a table for 10 hours, 11 hours? I was like, I said, if you've never done it, you wouldn't understand it. And I said, there are guys who can sit at a table for 24 hours. Like, it's just something that, you know, people do. Like, it's fun. And the poker community is small. So when I went out there and played, you know, they did the interview with me and everybody was like, oh, you got the interview? I was like, man, I'm just here to play poker just like you. I said, I just so happened to play basketball and, you know, they thought it was cool to interview me, and it was a cool little interview, but I enjoy going out there. It's, you see a lot of familiar faces. You know, I've met a lot of friends throughout the United States in different places, to where, you know, we go to lunch, you know, we're Facebook friends, they send text messages, you know, we check up on each other. So it's a, you know, it's a really cool group of guys from, you know, all walks of life, young, old, rich, poor, black, white, you know, good, bad, it doesn't matter. It's a fun group, and it's a really, really large community of people that play, that you don't realize that poker is big in the U.S.
It is big. I think the first time I like really heard that they had like a World Series, I think Ben Affleck was in it, the actor. And I watched a couple. I don't have that patience to sit and watch it.
Yeah.
You know, you mentioned something about paying attention to what other people do and those kind of things. And as a pro athlete, I would think you're always paying attention to people, strangers coming up to you and trying to figure out what they may want from you. Does that skill help you in poker, being able to sit back and watch and analyze people, I guess, is what I'm asking.
Kind of, sort of, you know, a lot of times just depends on the mood. You know, I might be very talkative, and other times I'll put on some earbuds and some shades and just turn it down really low to where I can just hear what people are saying. Like, they realize that I'm not paying attention. And a lot of times something will happen and the dealer might do something wrong, and I'll correct her, and she was like, you know, he or she'll be like, I didn't even know you were paying attention. I started laughing. I was like, yeah, I am. And I'll be the only one that caught it. I was like, you gave him $100 too much, or he bet this, and this is not, that's not right. I said, can you count that again?
And she'd be look at you.
So it's, you know, I love math, so I'm quick to.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of math when it comes to the pots and how much to bet, overbetting. Right. And, you know, it's just, the more you play, the more you learn. And, you know, like I said, there's nothing besides patience and a little bit of skill that separates, you know, Sandy from somebody who won the World Series. Right. Like there's no, you know, there's not that big of a gap besides patience and understanding, you know, position and, you know, knowing when to just say, forget it and go all in. So,
do you still play today?
I sure do. I don't play as much. So I probably play once every couple of weeks. You know, I'll go. Like this weekend, I might go play for a couple of hours, but I like to play tournaments, and tournaments just take up so much time. So it's kind of like I have to have a 2-3 day window to where I'm locked in to where, especially the big tournaments are multi-day tournaments. Like the tournaments I like to play last 2 days minimum, sometimes three. A couple of tournaments that I've ran pretty deep in. Basically, you're from noon to 1 a.m. you're playing poker, and you go home, take a nap, go to the gym, eat, you're back the next day doing it again, and you're just dwindling down to where, you know, it's crazy to go in a room with 1500 people to where you just see tables everywhere, and over the course of a few hours you look around and the tables just start, you know, the chairs start moving, and people start getting up, and they go to other empty chairs. And then you look up, you're like, man, it was 100 tables in here. Now it's only 40.
Right.
And you look at the clock, you look at the time. And it's like, well, you know what? I'm just going to keep grinding and doing what I'm supposed to do and try not to make any bad decisions. And then you look around, and it's like, man, it's three tables left. It's 30 people left. It's narrowing down. And it's fun. So that's the part that I enjoy, you know, being in large fields to where some people call it the lotto, you know, but at the end of the day, you know, it's fun. And, you know, hopefully this year I'll go out there and, you know, make a name for myself and run deep in one of the tournaments, and I can call you and be like, hey, Sandy, guess what I did?
Let's talk about you decided to end your career. You wanted to be able to see your kids grow up. What was that process like? You make the decision, and like, what did you do then? Like, you make the decision. Were you currently playing, or you? I think you said you were in between or something.
What
was that process?
I was in Japan for maybe 5 months. I think Kaysen was 2 at the time.
Right.
And so, kind of knowing where I was in my career, you know, knowing, you know, how my wife felt about me being gone for, you know, months at a time, and then where my son was, and age wise, I kind of was like, you know, my only options would be to bring my whole family overseas, which, you know, they would sit in the house all day or try to learn language or, you know, do something of that nature. But, just at his age, I was just like, you know, I'm not there yet. If he was a little bit older, you know, maybe he can go there and go to school and, you know, learn, you know. But that young, I was just like, yeah, it's just, it's a lot. You know, you're never really at home, you know, you're on all day. And then, you know, when you're on the road, like, what do you do? You know, you need translators, especially in certain countries. So I just was like, you know what? I'll start to see if I'm able to, you know, have some connections with coaching and see if, you know, there were some openings. And I told my agent to reach out to some coaches. I would love to get into some player development or scouting. And then nothing came through. So there was a period of time to where I didn't work for maybe a year. Like, I didn't do anything.
It
was hard. It's, you know, you talk, a lot of players talk about being in a dark space, and that was a dark space to where, you know, my whole life, all I knew was, you know, after high school was basketball, you know.
Exactly.
Basketball was my job. Basketball was breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Wake up basketball, wake up running, lifting weights, doing cardio, getting in shape, right, measuring body fat, watching film, getting on a plane, getting off a plane, checking in the hotels, doing scouting reports. That was my life for 14 years. So after that, it's kind of like, man, minus the travel, I still want to do it. But, you know, having a family, you know, you have to make sacrifices. So had I not had a family, I probably would have played another 3-4 years, who knows where. But, you know, my son probably was the main reason to why I was just like, you know what? I don't know if anybody remembers, I think it was Monte Ellis at the time. He was still in his prime, but he was from Jackson, Mississippi. He came out of high school, played in the league for a long time. And I remember having a conversation with him, and he was just saying like, man, I want to retire. And I was like, you came out of high school, you're still in your 20s. But he was just like, he's like, man, I don't get to see my kids. He said, I love my kids. He said, man, I think he had two at the time. He was like, man, I just, you know, you blink and, you know, a whole season has gone by and you've missed everything. So, you know, I kind of saw it leaving and then coming back and seeing how big he was. I was just like, man, I'm missing out, because life is so short. Like I said, I've had lost a lot of guys. I call them my hoop brothers, over the past 5-10 years for whatever reason. But it's just like, you know what? I love the game, but I also, you know, that I'd rather, you know, be around my kids and spend some time with them and, you know, try to be a good father to them and teach them some things and instill some values in them that'll last a lifetime while I'm, you know, while I'm gone.
So did your son help you get through that year of, because you go from, as you said, you go from all this structure, all this purpose that you have to do every single day and you've done for years to not having all that. Like, how do you get from day to day to day? And you're right. A lot of the guys on here have talked about, especially we had some Harlem Globetrotters on here that talked about how difficult life was after they got out, from, because they suddenly had to do things for themselves. Like, you know, for the Globetrotters, their hotels were booked, everything, and everybody, they didn't even have to wait in line.
That's a struggle, you know, when it's time to travel, when it's, you know, I like to cook. So, you know, that's another thing that you get some of the best meals, you get chefs, you get catered food, you know, it kind of spoils you. But I would say that's something that being in the minor league and in overseas, that kind of helped me get to that point to where I would, you know, I knew how to cook. You know, I love to cook. I love, you know, all kind of meals. So I would cook for my kids.
Several of the guys have talked about, that played overseas, have talked about how they love to cook. They learned to cook because that was like, there wasn't a lot to do.
Yeah. So that was, you know, besides playing video games, you know, which I played young, but we would play in the D League. We would sit around and go to somebody's apartment and play 2K, play basketball or Madden for hours, just to, you know, nobody really wanted to go anywhere, and we would do that and spend some time together, but it was a lot of camaraderie. One year we played, probably one of the other closest teams I played on was in Bakersfield, California. And when they were talking about going out or something, and one of the guys was like, I was like, what y'all gonna do tonight? I just got there and they were there the previous year. And they was like, oh, we're going back to my apartment and play Monopoly. And I was like, Monopoly? And I said, so you joking, right? He's like, no. He said, Monopoly is serious in my apartment. I was like, I said, all right, I'm going to come and play. So I ended up going and I hadn't played Monopoly in forever. And so they revised me and, you know, broke down the rules again. And I watched a couple rounds and I was like, all right, let's go. And so we would keep a tally on who got wins. And it would get, we would literally play Monopoly for 5-6 hours. So the coach was like, he's like, man, we get complaints from other apartments of how loud y'all are at 2-3 in the morning. I'm just like, I'm like, coach, man, the game got really serious. And, you know, it got real. You know, we play music, sit around and, you know, have a good time. But, you know, we built a lot of chemistry. And that was probably one of the best teams as far as, you know, bonding, having right. each other back, you know, a phone call or a text away for anything. And, you know, those Monopoly days, man, we still joke about it to this day, how fun and how, you know, how cool that was. And it was eye-opening to me because I didn't expect Monopoly to be that fun, but it was something we looked forward to. Honestly, we looked forward to it after practice. We would go hard in practice. We would do weights. We'd right. shower. We'd be getting ready to go back to the apartment. We'd be like, hey, what are we going to eat so we can get this Monopoly started at 7, like 7 o'clock. Okay. Meet y'all here. We're gonna get the first dice are going to be rolling at 7 o'clock. And it was so much fun.
Okay, so after the year of doing nothing, how did, like, what was that first job that you got?
The first job was, that was the Suns D League team. So I was doing assistant coaching, player development with them. And then after that ended, I kind of wanted to go back and play. Like, I was in the gym every day. I was shooting every day. I was working out with the guys. I would go lift weights. I would run on the treadmill. Like, I was right. literally keeping myself in shape like I was playing. And so after that season, I kind of was like, oh, I kind of want to go back and play. I know my body feels good. But, you know, I look over at my little man. I was like, man, I can't leave you for, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 months. And so basically, I just start going to different high schools and went to the Suns facility, see what they had going on and see if they had any openings for scouting or any kind of positions. And basically didn't work for a while. I, you know, still played poker occasionally on the weekend and, you know, basically had my savings. At the time, my house was paid for. I really didn't have any bills. My car was paid for that I bought, you know, back when I played in Miami. So that cheap side of me kind of paid off because I really didn't have a lot of bills at the time. So that kind of worked out in for that situation, not working. And, you know, my wife at the time was working and, you know, the money that I made playing poker was more than enough. Wasn't a lot, but, you know, I don't want to get into the amounts, but, right. You can do really well, you know, a couple times a week. Playing. So I did that. And then, you know, just applying for something with basketball. Like I just wanted to do basketball. And then was going to start my own training company and COVID hit. So when COVID hit, midway through COVID, I got turned into the mortgage industry. And, one of the guys was like, man, you can become a mortgage loan officer. And, with the rates right now, you can do really well. So by the time I passed my exam, I got offered a job with the Pacers as an assistant coach.
Okay.
So did that during COVID. And when the season ended, I still had my license. And so I did the mortgage thing for a year. Didn't work for a few months. And then I volunteered at a local high school. And then didn't work for a couple months. And then I applied and got the job that I have now. So, now just balancing work and life and being a dad, you know, right. with everything that I have going on, but still, you know, I know how important it is for my job to make connections and make myself vulnerable. So, you know, it's just a matter of me opening up and just through conversations with people. It's like, hey, this is what I do. I would love to sit down and have a casual conversation to discuss, you know, what you're doing. It's nothing that you know, it's free. Just a free plan. See if you have any gaps or voids in anything that you're doing. And I would love to be, you know, a resource. And some people find it valuable and some people feel like they got it figured out. And it's the tough part of this business, because I saw that with mortgages, to where people would argue with me. It's like, oh, the rates are going back down. I'm like, do you know how the rates were 10 years ago? Like 10% was, you know, 8, 9, 10% was the norm. And now you're looking at 3% and it's going up to 4, maybe 5. And people are like, nah, I'm going to wait. I'm going to hold out. And so it's like now rates are 7%. So all those people 2 years ago that I was trying to get to refinance and do all these different things, once I learned the ins and outs of the mortgage industry, that felt like they had it all figured out. Oh, no, I'm good. I'm like, you sure you don't want to pay off all this debt? You sure you don't want to?
Everyone thinks they're an expert in something that they know nothing about, which is funny. Kind of like those couch coaches that we hear all the time.
Gosh, the couch coaches and the trainers that just do all kind of weird things. And I'm just like, what happened to fundamentals? They got kids holding water bottles in their mouth with a tennis racket in the left hand, dribbling the basketball with the right hand. Like, what is that working on? Like, that's not going to help them out anyway.
I would think because if I look at the marketing aspect of it, I would think that your life as a professional athlete would help talking to people about, you know, the ins and outs of what you learned about managing your income, managing your investments. I would think that, to me, that would be something that would have more, what's the word I'm looking for? Value than somebody that's just out of college who has that degree, maybe has an MBA, like who hasn't really lived life. I would think that career aspect that you have would help entice people to listen to you and hopefully sign them as a client.
Yeah, it's all about, so basically, like, it's all about having a plan. So me personally, I didn't really have a plan. I just had some money that I invested. Right. But when it comes to a plan, it's understanding, you know, the ins and outs of having a, what you call a holistic plan, to where you have insurance, you have investments, you retirement, you have everything you need, to where your trajectory is going to say, hey, at this point, at this age, this is where you're going to be, and this is where you should be, as opposed to, okay, what you're doing now, you want to retire at 62, this is what 62 looks like at inflation with what you're doing right now. And so it's eye-opening. It's frustrating to, because I look at it like, I wish I had someone to point me in the right direction and give me the proper plan when I was even coming out of college. Me and Nathaniel Root, we talk about it all the time. We was like, man, had we known what we know now, we could have done so many different things financially, investment wise, insurance wise, coming out of college, to where we would be sitting back like, man, aren't you glad we did this? And we sat down and did this. So it's eye opening and it's learning. So I just love, you know, connecting with people, helping people out in whatever way I can. And, you know, I'm looking forward to what the future holds.
So I'll put all your contact information for your website and everything. I'll put that in the show notes for everybody if they want to reach out to you. And
I would love to talk to my fellow Memphians and help them out in any way that I can. I work with a great group of advisors. My team is amazing. You know, so a bunch of people have been there for years. And we work over all fields, teachers, engineers, Boeing, you know, you name it, lawyers, whatever. We do it. So
our podcast is aired not just in Memphis, it's aired across the country, and people overseas even listen to it. You never know. So I want to ask this. Do you miss playing? Are there days when you just get that itch and you miss that excitement?
Definitely miss it. I go to the rec in the morning sometime. They play at like 6 in the morning. So I'll get up in the morning and go play. A few older guys, but there are a few young guys that come in there. But just the team aspect, you know, I love the, you know, tomorrow might be your day. Right. Sunday, it might be my day. You know, you're on a high horse on Fridays. Like, oh my gosh, Sandy had 24 rebounds. Like, oh my gosh. And then, you know, the next day, you know, I have a double-double. But the love and the support is mutual, because we all know at the end of the day, we need each other in order to win. And so when you're on a team that's winning, you guys have fun on the court and off the court. Sure. And that's the part that I miss when, you know, you have guys that are unselfish, willing to sacrifice shots, minutes, you know, whatever it may be in order to win. And once people start buying into it and you have a whole team of people collectively going out every night, taking charges, you know, passing up good shots for better shots for their teammate.
Right.
That's fun. And when everybody sees it, when it clicks and it makes sense, that's some of the best times I've ever had in my career on the court.
Is there anything else that you do to kind of help take away that itch for basketball other than, I guess, poker?
I'll watch it and then I'll go work out. I'll go to the gym. I'll put my earbuds on and I'll, you know, I'll run on the treadmill or get on the Stairmaster, you know, I'll lift weights just to, because I tell the people a lot of times, I know where I was physically in my prime.
Right.
And I see a lot of players that play and when they stop playing, it's just like, okay, they don't need to work out. They can eat different things. They can drink beer. And then they just blow up. And I was just like, I never want to be that person that blows up to where I'm not active. I'm not able to go into a gym and show a kid like, hey, this is how you, you know, this is where you should set a screen, or this is how you should space. Let me show you this move and be able to actually show them while I'm able, you know, 40-something. I'm like, it's a lot of guys that can't move because once they got done playing, they were just like, hey, working out is not anything that's going to be part of my life anymore. And that's something that I always, you know, people see me and they're like, man, you still look like you can play. And I was like, yeah, I probably could, but the older you get, you know, the faster the other guys get.
That's right.
The slower we get, but the faster the other guys get. So,
but you know, the other aspect of it is, you know, you guys aren't 5'9" or anything. Like you're 6'12", you know, 6'5", 6'6", 6'7". In order to stay healthy, you need to work out some. You can't just let your body go. It's too big to just let it go. Your ankles, your knees, everything will start just wearing out.
Yeah. So I've never had any kind of tendonitis issues, shin splints or anything of that nature. And I do not want them. So I love, you know, picking up my kids. I love doing things with them, running around, you know, being active, jumping in the pool, doing flips, doing all kind of silly stuff with them because I'm, you know, I'm still active. I can go out and kick a soccer ball, play catch with my neighbors, do different things. And I enjoy doing that, being someone who has, you know, been around sports and just been active, you know, like I said, cross country, tennis, basketball in high school. Like, it's just something I just love. I love, you know, sports, riding bikes, hiking, you know, doing things of that nature. It's just part of my nature.
Staying active. Okay. So what's one item on your bucket list?
Whew, my bucket list, man. I want to go travel the world again, but I want to go to like see some of like the seven wonders of the world. Like I want to go to Egypt. I want to see the pyramid.
That's on my top of my bucket list. The pyramid.
I did. You know, I want to go to like Peru. You know, I want to go see different beautiful sites. Scotland, Ireland. I want to go to places like that because I think the older you get, you start to. You know, you're younger, you see stuff on TV, you know, random stuff, a car driving on the coast, and you're just like, that is beautiful. Like, I just want to go there. And
exactly.
There, drink a beer at the bar and look out the window at the ocean. Like, but, you know, I would say that basketball has allowed me to see some things that I never would have been able to see. Going to the Great Wall in China was something was amazing. Playing in Taiwan, Taipei 101 is I think the second tallest building in the world, has the fastest elevator in the world. So being able to, you know, do that, you know, to the Philippines, traveling and all the food, I'm picky when it comes to food. So I don't eat sushi, seafood, squid, some of the raw stuff, not for me, but being able to travel, and I did try goat in Turkey. So I went to one of the nicest restaurants restaurants in Turkey, and I had some kind of goat from one of the top restaurants, and I tried it and I was hungry, and then I ate one and I was like, can't do it again. And so you know, just being in these different places, Japan, you know, just traveling and hearing the stories and being part of the culture and sitting around the table with chopsticks, twirling a table, you know, taking food off, being with my teammates, and they're like, "Oh, you eat chopsticks?" I'm like, "Yeah, I eat chopsticks too," you know. And you know, being in the Philippines, I never forget being in the Philippines, and we won a interleague tournament or something. And the GM and the coach was like, "Are you going to drink with us tonight?" And I was like, "Sure, I love to drink." And so we sat at this huge table. This is in the Philippines, and like, you know, different countries have their beer, and their beer was, I think, San Miguel. So they had, San Diego probably was 15 crates of beer, you know, each crate has 8 to 10 beers in it. And they put all the beers on the table, and a bunch of the guys, the other guys on the team and a couple of the staff, and they sat out, and I can't remember how many beers I drank, but, you know, those experiences are just something that, you know, had I not been around the game, I would never been a part of. And those are just stories that I like to, you know, share and tell people. It's like, man, basketball has taken me around the world and back, you know, many times. I've built a lot of relationships. I touched a lot of people, a lot of kids, a lot of families. You know, it's just, you know, thankful to you know, not knowing where this game can take you, you know, and being where I am right now, just, you know, super thankful and, you know, have the support and the friends and the fans and, you know, all that good stuff.
What do you think your value is now to people?
Just being nice. Like, I just like to, you know, be generous and put a smile on people's faces and, you know, just acts of kindness, whatever I can do, you know, a smile, a good morning, you know, a lot of times it goes a long way.
It does. It really does.
Grab a bottle of water for somebody on a hot day, sitting outside, like, here you go, man. It's hot. Like, here. You
know, right.
Just little things. And, you know, throughout life, you do certain things and people kind of remind you. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't have to do it for likes or follows or anything like that. But when people come to you and say, "Hey, I just want you to know that you did something and I really appreciate it. And it meant a lot to either me or my son or my daughter or my wife or something, anything." Those are the reasons why I do it. And, you know, throughout coaching, I've had players reach out and say, "Hey, coach, I just want to say thank you so much for X, Y, Z." And it's just like, damn, like that.
Yeah.
No amount of salary or anything can value how much that means to have somebody to reach out and just say, "Hey, man, thank you for being you. You know, thank you, you know, helping me. Thank you for doing whatever it may be that you did." And, you know, that's the value that I want to bring. And that's the value I want to, you know, bring to my kids to say, "Hey, you know, me growing up where I grew up, I guess my mom kind of put me in a circle to where I really didn't judge anybody." I went to a predominantly all white elementary school. I went to an all black junior high, and then I went to a kind of mixed high school. So going to Memphis and leaving and going overseas was like, okay, now I'm around different cultures that they're different. They talk different. It's like, okay, I just have to adjust and show who I am and be who I am. And, you know, I've even had guys was like, "Man, you're the only American that doesn't do this, or you don't talk like that." And I was like, "Well, thank you. You know, you know, I'm different." So I was just like, "Hey, man, I'm just here to, you know, be a good teammate and have a good time, you know, and learn and, you know, and grow." So that's all I can do.
What would you tell a 9-year-old Earl?
Woo, man. A 9-year-old, I mean, having a 7-year-old, he tells me now, like, he wants to be grown. He doesn't like to be bossed around. He doesn't like to be told what to do. And he's like, "It's not fair. It's not fair. You know, I have to do this. I have to get up. I have to go to school." I was like, "Guess what?" I said, "You're going to have to do that for a long time." And I said, "Until you get to be an adult and you can do things on your own." And I'll tell him, I said, "I'll tell you what, daddy's going to go get something to eat. And I'm going to take your brother with me and you can stay here and I'll be back later on." He's like, "You can't leave me by myself." And I was like, "You're an adult, right?" I said, you know, "If I leave," I said, "I'm going to drive to Clarksdale and I want you to figure out how to eat, you know, how to get around, you know, I'll leave you some money." And he was like, "But you can't do that." And I was like, "You said you wanted to be an adult." So, you know, just take school seriously, you know, listen to your, you know, your teachers. You know, they only mean the best for you. Teachers have it really tough these days. So, you know, just work hard and dream big. Don't let anybody else stand in your way, but also don't compare what you're doing to anybody else's, because everybody's situation is different. So
that's exactly right. You don't know. Everybody is different. It doesn't matter how many years they've been playing or where they live or what money they have. Everybody is different. And that, I wish more people paid attention to that. Real quick, March Madness is going on. Although I think when yours is going to air will be after March Madness. But who do you have picked to win the tournament?
I'm going to glance really quick. You know, I had my boys this past weekend, so I missed a lot of games. But
I will say the Houston-Texas A&M game was pretty good.
It was. So I would say I'm going to pull for Houston. I like their coach. I like their program. Mm-hmm. But I also like North Carolina, because they've had, you know, always look at their center who's been there for 3 or 4 years. And you talk about, you know, the camaraderie and the one and done. Yeah. Like, these are the teams that win. Those teams that have been together for 2-3 years,
sure,
that have, like us, we went from almost making the NIT to making the NIT, to winning the NIT, to making the NCAA tournament. And we had guys who were there for 2, 3, 4 years.
Right.
And now you have, you know, I love to see those programs where they have, you know, 2-3 seniors who've been there 2-3 years. They might have a transfer, but he's been there 2 years and doesn't plan on leaving. So Houston has that kind of program. North Carolina has a bunch of guys that are, you know, have been there for a while. So, it's going to be a interesting little run. Clemson, I like to see, you know, those little underdogs sneak in and make some noise. But Houston, I think I'll be cheering for. Unfortunately, I'll probably end up cheering for Tennessee as well.
No.
I might have to cheer for Tennessee.
I am not orange.
If the Tigers can't win it, I would like to see another team in Tennessee.
No, everybody I graduated high school with all like went to Tennessee. Like, I grew up with everybody loving Tennessee, and I just don't like it. And even when I lived in Houston, the only orange I will ever wear is for the Astros. Like, that's it.
It's funny how, like, I wasn't a Tiger fan growing up.
Exactly.
Once you get in Memphis, you realize, like, oh, that's our rival. We do not like them.
That's right.
I like orange, and they don't like blue. And if you go to Tennessee and you play in Memphis, and when I went in that stadium, I was like, this is unbelievable. All this orange, and they just hated Memphis.
Oh, they do.
The Bears hated us. The fans hated us. It was crazy.
It is.
So to this day, I'm not an orange fan. I'll wear it in, you know, every blue moon. But I think I have one orange sweater, and the last time I wore it, one of the Tennessee fans was like, oh, I like your, he's a friend of mine, he's a Tennessee fan. He's like, I like that sweater. I was like,
no.
I took it off.
Okay, we're going to wrap this up. I think yours is the longest interview we've done so far. But that's all good. You had lots to share. And so we're going to wrap this up. Any last comments?
No last comments. Thanks. Thank you for, you know, having me on. This is one of the first podcasts I've done, probably the first podcast. I've done some phone call interviews, but
excellent.
I know podcasts are growing, and something that I'll probably start trying to dibble and dabble in and getting on more podcasts and share my story.
Exactly. And because I do personal branding, career strategy also, I think podcasts are a really great way to help. Not necessarily, it's hard to monetize a podcast unless you're like got millions of downloads, but it's a good way to market yourself, not only having your own to showcase that expertise, but also then to go and be guests on other podcasts, because you never know who all is listening and what all they do. When I started this is my third one I've had. I only have two going right now, but I love sharing people's stories. Like, you know, when I lived in Houston, I had the opportunity to meet so many amazing people, like ordinary people with like all these interesting lives. And I always love like figuring out like how did they get from there to there? And I just became really, you know, inquisitive about everybody. It's just fascinating. And so I was looking at a way to share those stories. And so I started a podcast literally like on a Friday night. I was like, hey, I'm going to do this. And I just, COVID hit and everybody was bored. And so I like started getting, and that's when I started doing it on Zoom, and everybody like had all their time. And I started interviewing like people I went to college with, and it was great to catch up, and they have crazy, interesting lives too. And I just started branching out. And then Michael Wilson reached out to me last summer and was like, hey, you know, I'm thinking about starting this one. And I was like, I'm not an athlete. Like, who am I to go and interview? But it's all about your career and like your resilience and your strategy and how you persevere and everything that fits in with me. And he had to step back because of his time. But I love doing these. I think it's
you
just
see my
really,
tiger wall.
I see that.
My tiger wall.
I just think it's really fascinating. You know, everybody's story is different, and it's just so fun and interesting to hear like why somebody got into something and, you know, the things that they figured out about themselves and, you know, why they quit and, you know, how they felt after that. And it's something that everyone goes through regardless of if they play sports. When I lived in Houston, I worked for a nonprofit and I taught job search, and we had all these engineers that came through who had been laid off, and they had master's degrees. Some of them had PhDs, and they lost their self-confidence. They didn't think they had any value, and they didn't know how to market themselves. They didn't know how to go out and network. And it just became, you know, I saw so much more than just teaching somebody how to write a cover letter. You know, it became more than that. And so this kind of fits in it. And I love basketball and I love, you know, sports. And so it's been really crazy. And, yours will air later on in April, but Todd Munt's wife, who mm-hmm. I had not met, she was a 2-time national champion in rowing, once in high school and then in college at Northeastern in Boston with the men's team. And I found out about that, and we did her interview last week, and it's going to air tomorrow. And I was just like, it really is fascinating. Like all these people and the interesting things that they do. So I get a little excited about that. So anyway, thank you so much. And let me get my notes here. Thank you so much for joining us. All the Memphis fans are going to be all excited about this. And as we wrap up this episode, thank you all for listening and sharing our episodes and your comments and share reviews. Please take a moment to like, share, and review our podcast on Apple. And also remember to go and subscribe on YouTube. I appreciate each and every one of you for all of your support. Thank you for joining us on this episode of the Fifth Quarter Podcast with our guest, Earl Barron. Until next time, remember, change is our ally and it paves the way for greatness. Stay inspired. Have a great rest of the week.
Thank you, Sandy.